Hi, welcome to another edition of Hub Bites. I'm Sanil Rege, consultant psychiatrist from Psych Scene. Today I'll be talking about two specific forms of depression, melancholic depression and psychotic depression. Now you might have heard the term melancholia. Now melan comes from melanin black, while cholia is linked to bile. And that's where we have, you know, cholecystitis, gallbladder involvement. So it's linked to bile. So melancholia was traditionally, during Hippocratic times, described as black bile. It was thought to be due to the fault of the heart, you know, talked about black bile. They also used terminology such as loss of tone in the brain going really cold. And this was described during Hippocratic time, 5th century BC, but also somewhere around the period from 50 to 100 AD by Rufus of Ephesus. And there's lots of other Greek philosophers who've talked about melancholia. Now, why am I talking about melancholic and psychotic depression? It's because it's the sort of depression that flies under the radar, very easy to miss, and misdiagnoses are associated with it. Both these depressions are associated with a very high degree of morbidity and mortality, particularly suicide. And that's the reason why it's so important that we don't miss these two forms of depression as clinicians. So the STOP-PD study actually showed that only 5% of individuals with psychotic depression receive an adequate treatment of antidepressants and antipsychotic medications. 27.1% of individuals are misdiagnosed in psychotic depression, and mainly due to missing the psychosis part of the diagnosis. And we'll see why that's the case. And it happens because the thought processes in psychotic depression are not traditionally the same as one would find in schizophrenia. The bizarreness might not always be present, and that's the reason it can be missed. So we'll talk about that further when we come to sort of clinical features. So melancholic and psychotic depression have some key attributes, some key features. Firstly, there is a significant change often in psychomotor activity, and that's one of the key features you find clinically. So they might either be retardation, and you find the individual slows down, that this could be slowing of thought or slowing of physical activity as well. Or they go the opposite way, where you have agitation, and patients may often in the room, you might find them pacing about or wringing their hands, or you might find the facial agitation, other forms of motor agitation as well. And there's a third component, which is the non-interactiveness. And here you often find speech, the lack of spontaneity of speech, lack of facial expressions, etc. Family members can often describe individuals as having, you know, loss of twinkle in their eye, they're not the same person, ums and ahs during talking, they've changed in personality. These are the sort of hints that point towards a more severe form of depression. Now, interestingly, melancholic depression often occurs as part of a late life type depression, and there may be vascular features associated with it. So I'd written an article on white matter hyperintensities, which you can find on the Psych Scene Hub. And we often find when we carry out scans in individuals with melancholic or psychotic depression, there might be significant white matter hyperintensities in the brain. So they tend to have what's called a vascular form of depression or a subcortical form of depression, which means the subcortical areas, which are the basal ganglia areas, are involved. And we know that from the subcortical areas, there are connections to the frontal lobe. And which is the predominant neurotransmitter here? Dopamine. And that's one of the reasons why SSRIs don't tend to work as effectively in melancholic depression. And we often require, as we'll see later in treatment, broad spectrum antidepressants. So that's one of the other features, that SSRIs are unlikely to work in melancholic forms of depression and in psychotic depression as well. The other features are there may be physical changes. So constipation may be found, low blood pressure in females, menstrual irregularities, low blood pressure. These are some of the physical changes. Loss of weight is another really, really important one. Can occur on its own, but also due to loss of appetite. The other aspect here to consider is that there is a significant biological weighting in both melancholic and psychotic depressions. So with that in mind, what are the red flags that tell you that you might be looking at possibly a melancholic depression? So a sudden change in psychomotor activity is one of the really, really good clues, and that might be social withdrawal, or a sudden onset of intense agitation or panic, maybe the other aspect you might find. You often find sleep disturbances, and one of the classical features is early morning wakening. So they often wake up at 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock, much earlier than the usual time of waking up, and bang, they immediately have these worrying thoughts, which we call ruminations or overvalued ideations, and these can be really all-consuming. We often find changes in appetite. I mentioned there's a loss of appetite. Sometimes they talk about change in their taste as well. So they don't enjoy food as much, and that results in loss of weight. Now, with the thoughts, it's really interesting because patients with melancholic and psychotic depression don't tend to have the classical persecutory paranoid delusions, but the thought processes revolve around themes of hopelessness, pessimism, thoughts of inadequacy. I'm not a good father, I'm not a good parent, I'm not a good mother, I'm not a good worker, I'm going to lose my job. So these are the kind of themes that are present. And most importantly, these thoughts tend to be all-consuming, and hence the terminology ruminations or overvalued ideations. Now, often when this gets worse, we can enter into delusional belief systems, and the kind of thought processes that we often find are hypochondriacal. So concerns about actually having an illness. I've had a patient where they've thought there was something actually wrong on the insides, that they were going to die. Other patients, for example, there's something wrong with their heart, something wrong with their skin. There could be lots of other hypochondriacal belief systems, and this could either be overvalued ideation or in some cases actual delusions, so fixed firm false belief systems. Sometimes you have delusions of poverty. I had a patient, and you know, in the article that I've written on melancholic depression and psychotic depression on the Psych Scene Hub, I've covered two cases, and in one of the cases the patient thought that they had no money, they'd reached financial ruin. I've actually had two cases like this where the credit cards have run out of money. You know, you can have delusions of poverty as well. The other aspects can be related to sense of inadequacy. So in one of the other cases, the patient presented with a type of imposter syndrome, that they felt that the work they were doing at work, at their workplace, was very poor and that they were going to lose their job. So these are the kind of themes that you often have. And in some cases, the reason why it's easy to miss this is because one might think, well, some of these thoughts are sort of normal thoughts, normal stresses, but the preoccupation associated with it is clearly out of proportion, and that's what differentiates a normal thought from a rumination and an overvalued ideation. So the question that I often tend to ask is, what proportion of the day do you spend thinking about these particular thoughts? And the answers are often 70%, 80%, 90%. So really, really all consuming. So the key aspect I want to outline is that as part of the thoughts, you can have thoughts that might be normal stresses or just exaggeration of the normal stresses, but they tend to be all consuming. The themes can be hypochondriacal, so preoccupation with their physical health, but they can also be preoccupation with their finances or preoccupation with sort of sense of inadequacy, being a sense of failure. And another key aspect as a result of that is what we call obsessional guilt. So do look out for these symptoms. These often point to a more severe form of depression. So these are some of the red flags to consider in melancholic and psychotic depression. So what do we need to know about treatment? Remember, right at the start, I said the key areas of the brain involved often tend to be frontal and subcortical circuits. In fact, melancholic and psychotic depression has shown frontal subcortical circuits to be involved, and the key neurotransmitter there is dopamine. As a result of that, when we think about treatment, we need broad spectrum antidepressants for melancholic depression. So I'll cover melancholic depression first before coming to psychotic depression. Now, broad spectrum antidepressants, first line, often tend to be SNRI. So you get serotonin, noradrenaline reuptake inhibitors. There are other medications as well, such multimodal antidepressants such as vortioxetine that can be considered, or in order to consider to create a broad spectrum antidepressant, you can consider augmentation strategies such as an SNRI plus agomelatine, an SNRI plus mirtazapine. So these are some of the important broad-spectrum antidepressants to consider. The other broad-spectrum antidepressants that are effective are tricyclic antidepressants or MAO antidepressants. So these antidepressants, of course, should be prescribed under specialist treatment. A psychiatrist's input becomes very important. Now, the reason why I've written an antipsychotic here is because melancholic depression can present with agitation. When agitation is there, you may actually require an antipsychotic augmentation along with the antidepressant. And the reason why that's so important is because in the presence of agitation, if a broad spectrum activating antidepressant is prescribed, the patient may actually worsen and one may actually increase the risk of akathisia or even suicidal ideation or actual behaviors. So a very, very important point to take into account. There is some evidence that the milder levels of melancholic depression, one may consider TMS, but of course for treatment resistant melancholic depression, ECT is evidence-based electroconvulsive therapy. Next, what is the treatment for psychotic depression? The key aspect here is because psychosis is present, an antipsychotic should be considered right at the start. And a systematic review and meta-analysis has shown that the combination of an antidepressant plus an antipsychotic is more effective than one or the other. So do think about the antipsychotic in the early phases of treatment. So an antidepressant, in some cases an SSRI at milder levels, an SSRI plus an antipsychotic may work, but often one finds that you require a broad spectrum antidepressant plus an antipsychotic. Now, in clinical practice, I've often found that triple therapy, and we know that triple therapy in diabetes, for example, is necessary in very, very severe cases. Similarly, in severe cases of depression, such as melancholic or psychotic depression, we require triple therapy. What does that consist of? It often consists of a combination of two antidepressants to create broad spectrum. I want serotonin, I want noradrenaline, I want dopamine, because I really want to lubricate those subcortical frontal areas, which predominantly function through dopamine. So I create the broad spectrum antidepressant and I add on an antipsychotic to create that triple therapy, which works really, really well. And I've outlined this in those two cases in the article as well. So do have a read of that particular article. So if the patient does not respond to first line, of course, there are additional augmentation strategies such as lithium. Tricyclics can be considered, and an important aspect is ECT, electroconvulsive therapy, is evidence-based and a response rate of up to 95% in psychotic depression. So it's a very, very effective treatment, but of course, second opinion, risk-benefit analysis, because the side effects of ECT also need to be taken into account, particularly the cognitive, the memory issues that occur with electroconvulsive therapy. But it's really a risk-benefit analysis in severe forms of depression. An important caveat, TMS is not evidence-based in the treatment of psychotic depression. And you will see in the second case, TMS did not work for the patient. Why was that? Because the melancholic depression was much more severe and the patient also had ruminations, overvalued ideations, and agitation. So TMS is unlikely to work in situations like that. In fact, in the article, I've covered predictors of non-response, and severity of depression is a predictor of non-response. And if there's heightened anxiety or agitation, that's another predictor of non-response for TMS. So finally, some of the caution to take into account when treating melancholic and psychotic depression is if agitation is there, then do have a high index of suspicion for psychosis. And this is from the Black Dog Institute article on melancholic and psychotic depression. So antipsychotic may need to be introduced earlier. Second, if an antidepressant is prescribed, please do monitor for akathisia or worsening of agitation, as it can be linked to poor outcomes. And of course, finally, the important thing is always have a high index of suspicion for the thought processes in relation to psychotic depression, because the typical persecutory delusions that are present in schizophrenia aren't present here. They often revolve around themes of obsessional guilt, thoughts of inadequacy, pessimism, hopelessness, hypochondriacal ideation, and often beliefs about poverty or concerns about finances. So I hope that you found this useful. Again, it's very, very important that this is not to be construed as medical advice, but I hope that you found this particular video useful. If you've liked it, please subscribe to our channel, give this video a like. I'll be coming with lots of new videos as well. Please leave some feedback as well on the comment section. So with that, take care, stay safe. I'll see you in another edition of Hub Bites.